General, welcome to this segment of Inside the Numbers, and it's a privilege to have you with us today. When you were gone, and you've been out of the country, and I want to get into that here in just a second, but while you were gone, we held a military saves function up at the National Guard here in Charleston, and where we tried to help educate your troopers about the importance of savings, and particularly when they were gone and deployment overseas, things they may need to do to make sure that things are taken care of back home. Speaking of that, you were in Afghanistan. Tell us a little bit of why you were in Afghanistan and what you saw and how our troops are responding overseas.
Well, Mr. Gaynor, it's a pleasure to be here, and I really want to thank you and the elected officials here in the state. You know, West Virginia is a very pro-military state, and the elected officials, both at the Public Works, the governor, the state legislature, have been tremendously good to the men and women who serve our country. And I just came from Afghanistan, and I can tell you that the people of the state of West Virginia can be extremely proud of the people that we have over there, the soldiers and the airmen, and the outstanding job that they're doing there in Afghanistan. Our Special Forces Battalion, they've got about 380, 235 of which is West Virginia's portion. We have a company in Ohio and a company out of Rhode Island that are a part of the 2nd Battalion, and they were there with them. And plus, we had the 130th Airlift Wing actually there at Bagram,
right,
where they were located, flying support missions, both personnel and supplies, in and out of remote areas. Right. That the Special Forces are operating in Afghanistan.
And that's one of the first times that's happened, where our 130th Airlift Wing was supporting in a combat zone our own troops.
And I can tell you that they were so proud, both the Army and the Air, of being able to work together in a combat zone. And the tremendous support that was given by the 130th Airlift Wing and of the Special Forces, and the guys out in the field, when I got out to see these remote sites and talk to them, they couldn't say enough good things. Said it was great to have your own Air Force. So they were tremendously happy that they were there, because they took extreme measures to make sure that they were taken care of, and flew missions for them that weren't scheduled, that they just scheduled for them, and actually put supplies and people on aircraft to go all over the country. I mean, Special Forces operate with aid detachments, right, out in remote areas of the countryside. And we have 24 of those teams located all over eastern and southern Afghanistan in some pretty critical positions. And getting their supplies and the stuff that they need out to them on time can be the difference in being able to come back alive and not. So it was a tremendous effort.
In those teams, how many soldiers are normally in a team?
They're normally a 12-man aid team, and I think they've put an additional intel person on those teams, so there's 13 on each one of the teams. But they operate with the armed forces or of the country of Afghanistan, and they go out and try to police up the Taliban and the Al-Qaeda that's in the country. And also got to visit a prison there on Bagram, where there's 600 of the Taliban and Al-Qaeda that they have policed up, they're doing tremendous work.
And they're actually on the front line. You know, a lot of times I think when people think of our guards units and when they are deployed overseas, I think sometimes some people think, well, they're in support roles and functions, but our guys are right there on the front lines.
When I say that they're at the tip of the spear, they're where it's happening in Afghanistan. I mean, this is pretty much, even though we have a lot of conventional forces, the unconventional forces are the ones that's really out there where the Taliban's operating, and in the really dangerous zones. So they're right at the tip of the spear. And I can tell you that they're doing a tremendous job.
Yeah. Well, I tell you, I know it makes us all proud back here in West Virginia, knowing that the quality of the West Virginia National Guard. I mean, you all are renowned. Both the 130th Airlift Wing, they've gotten accolade after accolade every time they go into a combat zone and the job that they do. But the National Guard, our foot soldiers on the ground, are the same way. They really are something we should be proud of.
I tell you, the normal citizens across the state of West Virginia just don't have any idea of the sacrifices these men and women are making on a daily basis so that we can in turn keep the freedoms that we have and enjoy the kind of life that we have here in the United States of America. Yeah. And when you're over there and you see the way people live, I mean, when you get into Afghanistan, the third world nations, they're still living in the 17th century.
Yeah.
And a lot of times, just the general public don't want to change. They don't want to join the 21st century and what's going on. So there's a tremendous amount of stress and pressure and on our troops every day. But I can tell you, to every soldier that I've seen, they're out there putting their life on the line every day. Even while I was there, there were several instances, almost continuously, of troops in contact with the enemy and stuff going on. So the people in the state of West Virginia need to say a little prayer for these.
Absolutely.
They're in danger every day.
Yep. You raise an interesting point there. You talk about the stress our soldiers are under when they're there. They've got a lot of stresses. They've got not only the stress of combat, being in a combat zone, and the safety of their life, and those of their comrades around them, and they truly are dependent one on the other. One guy fail in his mission could cause all 12 of them their lives.
That's exactly right.
So they deal with that. They deal with that stress in the combat zone, as well as worrying about the family back home. You know, are the bills getting paid? Are the things being done? So when these guys, not only when they're deployed, are they dealing with a lot of stress? When they come back, they're dealing with a lot of issues as well. What have you seen in some of the things that you're having to deal with? And I know talking with you offline, you talked about the different roles that the Guard has had to expand into in trying to help our soldiers deal with not only the stress of the combat, but also the stress of taking care of things at home.
Well, you know, the three-legged stool for readiness, the first thing we got to do is make sure that our soldiers are ready to go do their jobs, that they're qualified and that they can do the job that the military requires of them. The second leg of that stool is families. We have to have a good family readiness program that takes care of the families while those soldiers are deployed so that they don't have to worry about what's happening to their families back home. And the third leg of that stool is employers. We have got to educate the employers and make sure that they know and understand that these guys are not on a vacation. They're really over there defending our way of life and the freedoms that we enjoy. And if we can get that three-legged stool matched up the way it's supposed to be, then we'll be tremendously successful. And the thing that really amazes me is that the employers in the state of West Virginia have really stepped up to the plate. They went above and beyond what the federal laws and the state laws say they have to do. A lot of employers have paid the employees while they're gone, left them on their insurance benefits, and have just gone above and beyond. We've had very few serious employee problems. And I think that we put a lot of emphasis in trying to educate the employers across the state. We have a great employer support of the Guard and Reserve Committee, and they work all over the state educating employers who have guardsmen on what they do and why. And we continually are adding programs to our family assistance programs. I've always said that we do a tremendous job of preparing, getting our soldiers ready to go to war.
That's an easy thing for you guys. You're a soldier. Getting a guy ready to do that job, that's the easiest piece.
The most difficult is taking care of the families and taking care of the loose ends when they're deployed and when they come home. And those are the things that that I'm trying to improve and to make better so that we can give the soldiers the kind of services that they deserve.